Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is good that we might be gathered together for worship today. This truly is a day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I do welcome all of you who have come and gathered with us for worship here in the sanctuary. Those of you who are joining us online, we have created together a community of faith that gathers to worship and praise God. And for that, we give thanks and welcome all of you as a part of it today. Today is also a special day in the life of our congregation. It's the first Sunday in almost 3 years that we have been able to use the historic sanctuary. We had a Sunday school class meet in the historic sanctuary this morning, and it's a marvelous new space that we will be able to use on a regular basis in almost every day of the week as we look forward to ministry together in that place. It was used today. It'll be used tomorrow morning for Monday Musings. I hope you'll come and be a part of that time of conversation around the Sunday sermon that you hear today. We are planning a special rededication service for Sunday, November the 14th. And so I hope that you'll mark your calendars now. You'll hear more information about that in the coming weeks. But that'll be a special day for us as well. As we seek to extend God's love into the community, as we show that love for one another as well, today's the final day in the fall, anyway, where we will do safe place training for those who might be interested or feel called, or perhaps in the future will be interested or feel called to serving in ministry with children and youth in our community. It's the opportunity for us to be trained to be sure we can do that as safely as possible. So stay after church today to be a part of that if you've not yet participated in Safe Place training. Throughout this month, we are engaged in sharing the gifts that God has given us. We have been collecting our Dimes for Hunger offering throughout the month of September. We'll formally collect that today. The buckets will be in the narthex following the service. Those online with us can continue to mail in donations or also perhaps use the Give Now buttons on the church website. We are also beginning our food collection in the month of October, sharing God's bounty. It's an opportunity to pass on the gifts that we have received to our community, and the display shelves are up in the hallway for those who are here with us on campus that you can see and bring your food donations there as well. This coming Saturday is our first Habitat project. We'll be working in the Paradise community. We have two different projects that'll be for this coming Saturday. If you'd like more information about that, see information in the bulletin there as well. This morning is also Communion. It's World Communion Sunday. We will be celebrating here in the sanctuary using our pre-filled Communion cups. I hope you all picked those up as you made your way in today in the narthex. If not, be sure to head back and grab one before we get to that point in the service. Those of you worshiping at home, I hope that you will find those elements, bread and juice, or something for you to use as we celebrate communion later in the service today. Finally, we surround the family of Lucille Lee with our prayers in her death this week. Service for her will be held tomorrow at 3 p.m. at the Baker Funeral Home in Kershaw. Let us continue our worship together this morning.
Thank you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Please join me in the call to worship printed in your bulletin. To my sisters and brothers, I will tell your glory. O Lord, our God, how majestic is your name. In the great congregation, I will sing your praise. O Lord, our God, how majestic is your name. Let us worship God together.
Friends, this is the good news which we have received, in which we stand, and by which we are saved, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. In light of this good news, let us now join together in our prayers of confession, first together through the prayer found in your bulletin, and then individually through our silent prayers of confession. Let us pray. United in your love, O God, we are one body across the globe. We are branches of one family whose roots run deep in the waters of grace. Still, O Lord, we do not act like one body. We find ways to distance ourselves with more than miles. We are broken. Again and again, you call us back. Again and again, you repair what is broken within us and among us. Forgive us, uniting God, and by your forgiveness, challenge us to tend to each other's wounds. Amen. Who are we that God should care for us? Yet God calls us beloved children, and Jesus claims us as sisters and brothers. This is the good news of God's grace. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Our first scripture reading for today comes from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, chapter 11, verses 17 through 26, as Paul gives advice about the church gathering to eat together. Now, in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For to begin with, when you come together as a church, I hear there are divisions among you. And to some extent, I believe it. Indeed, there have to be factions among you, for only so will it become clear who among you are genuine. When you come together, it is not really to eat the Lord's Supper, for when the time comes to eat, each of you goes ahead with your own supper, and one goes hungry, and another becomes drunk. What? Do you not have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you show contempt for the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What should I say to you? Should I commend you? In this matter, I do not commend you. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It's the time in our service where we have opportunity for our young friends, the children, to come and spend a few moments together here on the steps. Just a few of us here today, I think, so come on down. We'll join together here in just a minute. Those of you online, draw near to the screen so you can be a part of this time as well. Thank you. Well, good morning. It's good to see you both today. I hope that you are doing well. I hope that it's a pretty day out there today. I hope we've got big things in plan for this afternoon and all kinds of fun that we can have today. Well, today's a special day for a couple reasons. One is, you can see at the communion table, we are going to celebrate communion today. It's also the last day that we've been collecting our dimes for hunger. And that reminds us of ways in which the food that we eat and the dimes that we share can be a part of helping others around the world to eat together. And I've got another picture for us today. This one here, I don't know if you can see. So we've got some folks who are here in this picture. And there is also a little baby as well. Well, this story is about these folks who had to go to find some food in Guatemala. Now, when we go to get food, we normally go to the grocery store, right? Have you ever been to the grocery store with your mom or your dad? Yeah, that's right. And maybe you even help them to carry bags of food when you get back home. That's right. They really appreciate that, don't they? Yep. Well, the children in this picture live in a rural community in Guatemala, which is a long way from where we live. And they went to get food with their mothers, but they don't have grocery stores like we do where they live, and they don't ride in a car. Instead, they had to walk several miles because last fall there were two hurricanes that came through their area within 10 days that washed out many of the roads and also caused major flooding in that region. So they had to walk a long way to be able to meet someone who brought them food so they'd have something to eat. La Mission, which is an agency in Guatemala that receives some of the dimes that we share for Dimes for Hunger, sent food to some of the villages that were isolated by the hurricane. And La Mission even included some formula so the baby in this picture here would be able to have healthy food to help her grow. So today we've got this opportunity to share our dimes, right? And we remember that we can care for and help our neighbors who are far away, who are hungry. It's the same way at communion. We remember that today, especially on World Communion Sunday, that we're not the only people who celebrate communion, but we get to join brothers and sisters around the world to be fed by Christ as we come to his table. So can you all remember that for me this week? All right, well, let's pray together, okay? Dear God.
Dear God.
We thank you.
We thank you.
For the dimes we share.
For the dimes we share.
And the meals we eat.
And the meals we eat.
That we can share with others.
That we can share with others.
Bless us.
Bless us.
And all the food we share.
And all the food we give.
As we come to your table today.
As we come to your table today.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Thank you all so much for coming up today. It was good to see you this morning. And we look forward to seeing you again soon. This morning is the fourth Sunday in a series of sermons on our congregation's annual vision for ministry for the program year 2021 and 22. If you're with us for the first time this morning, or just to remind you, if you've joined us before, that vision is connections. As Christ is the vine and we are the branches, we will seek to bear fruit by deepening, restoring, repairing, and forging new connections with Christ, with one another, and with our neighbors near and far. It's our hope that this vision will provide both inspiration and guidance for all of our ministry together over the next year. We began this series by looking at the guiding scripture for our vision and discovered that we are most intimately joined to Christ, to our neighbors, and to one another at the cross. We then explored the key verbs of deepening and restoring. And this morning we move to the next verb, which is repairing. This second scripture text for today comes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 58, verses 11 to 14. Hear these words as they were spoken to the people of Israel after They've returned from their exile in Babylon, and they find that the promised land is not quite what they expected it to be. Let us hear this word of God. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden with a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. If you refrain from trampling the Sabbath, from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, serving your own interests, or pursuing your own affairs, then you shall take delight in the Lord, and I will make you ride upon the heights of the earth. I will feed you from the heritage of your ancestor Jacob, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of all our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Does anyone repair anything anymore? There were once whole industries dedicated to repairing things. For example, if the sole wore out on your shoes, you would take those shoes to a cobbler to be repaired. I remember as a child when our television, you know, the ones that used to be as big as a cabinet, when it stopped working, my parents called a repairman who came to our house, who opened up the back of the television, replaced a variety of tubes and wires and bulbs, and voila, the TV worked again. We often try to have our cars and sometimes our major appliances repaired. But even then, there's a cost-benefit analysis, right? How much does the repair cost versus buying something new? We crunch the numbers, and most things we just replace. That was my first thought several years ago about a lamp at our house. I'd smelled a faint, strange burning smell and discovered that the lamp in our living room would not turn off. The knob turned freely with no effect on the light at all. So I did the only thing I could to get the lamp to turn off. I unplugged it. A few weeks later, I was telling my mother-in-law about how we were going to have to get a new lamp because I couldn't leave that one turned on all the time. And when I did, it smelled like it was burning. She looked at me and said, "You know, Matt, you can just replace the switch." I was shocked. Probably shows how influenced I am by our current culture, but it never occurred to me that a lamp could be repaired and not replaced. That it was even possible to remove one section of the lamp and repair it. But the next day I went to Lowe's Hardware. I paid just over $4 for a replacement switch. The nice lady at the store gave me instructions on how to remove the old part and install the new. I came home, I followed the instructions, I plugged the lamp in, and I received a jolt of electricity because I had not quite reassembled the lamp in my curiosity to see if it was going to work. So after my teeth stopped chattering and I unplugged the lamp, I finished reassembling it and all was well. Not long after moving here to Fort Mill, the lamp's matching pair suffered the same fate, and this time, I was able to repair it without shocking myself. But that's still a rare occurrence, at least for me in my life. How about you? How often do you repair things instead of replace them? I think as Christians, we live in this tension between repairing the old and embracing the new. We want to hold on to the old, and yet we're drawn to the shiny and the new. The word new actually appears almost 300 times in the Bible, and next Sunday we're going to talk about our call to forge new connections. But today I want us to rest, at least for a few moments, with repairing. Because despite our longing for and the promise of new, Scripture also gives us a clear call to repair what is broken. When the people of Israel were in exile in Babylon, they'd heard the prophet Isaiah tell them that their time in exile was over. God was sending them home, back to a land flowing with milk and honey. And they returned to this land of promise with great hope. And yet when they arrived, they found crumbling foundations and broken walls and a city in ruins. This is not what they had planned, nor what they'd expected. Difficult days with lots of hard work lay ahead of them. And into that despair, the prophet speaks again with another promise. This promise that the ancient ruins will be rebuilt and the people will be called repairers of the breach, the restorers of streets to live in. And so they set to work, and God was with them. Sometimes they made good progress. Sometimes it seemed like the ruins and the breaches grew faster than they could be repaired. They discovered that this work of repair would never be complete. As the generations passed, a myth and tradition developed in Judaism known as Tikkun Olam. These Hebrew words are typically translated as repair the world or even mend the world. Some would say that the perfection of God's creation had been shattered by human sin and transgression. But the conviction of Tikkun Olam is that it is the responsibility of human beings to act in such a way as to fix a broken world. This conviction inspired not just Jewish organizations through the centuries, but others as well, to work for things like human rights and to alleviate hunger, to end poverty. One recent commentator has written, in light of the current American moment, rife with dangerous social and political hostilities, it seems hard to argue with a resolve to take personal responsibility for creating a more just world, for alleviating human suffering, and for fixing a world in need of so much healing. My friends, is this a call that we as individuals can embrace? Even more, is it a call that we as a church can embrace? This call to Tikkun Olam, to be those who rebuild ancient ruins, repair the breach, and restore the streets. We want to say yes, right? We know that we're supposed to say yes. But in the back of our minds, I wonder if we start counting the cost. What is the cost of repairing a broken world? What's the cost to love those who are broken? What's the cost to repair the fractures that divide races in our neighborhoods, our community, and our world? What's the cost to restore a commitment to the common good in our society? What's the cost to repair systems that may benefit us but leave others out? What's the cost to love the broken pieces of ourselves? Yes, to repair the broken pieces of you and me. What's the price? It might be a cross. Yes, the cost to repair the world is a cross.
You couldn't pay it. I couldn't pay it. The only one who paid that price for you and for me is Jesus Christ. And that's good news, my friends. It's the very best news in the world. Because as hard as it is to admit it, the world is broken. You and I are broken. Our neighborhoods are broken. Our church is broken. Yes, even Unity Presbyterian Church is broken. We're broken. But the good news of the gospel is that Jesus Christ repairs broken pieces. It might be something like the tradition in Japan known as kintsugi. Tradition dates back to the 1600s, and legend says it began when a shogun broke his favorite tea bowl. He sent it away to be repaired, but was disappointed when it came back stapled together with metal pins. Local craftsmen, the poorest of the poor, proposed a different solution. They filled each crack in this bowl with a lacquer made with powdered gold. The result did not hide the cracks. No, it emphasized them, but it made the bowl even more unique and valuable. The repair elevated the fallen bowl to its place as the shogun's favorite. It prompted a whole new art form. Do you see how the joining of broken pieces actually enhances the value of those bowls? The broken pieces are repaired with gold. Could that be the case for you and for me? For our neighborhoods, for our country, and our world? Could we be far more valuable repaired than before we were broken? My friends, this year we're covenanting together to repair our connections with Christ, with one another, and with our neighbors. But I want to suggest to you that we ourselves do not hold that golden lacquer. No, our task is to hold the broken pieces, to pick up the shards that have been shattered, to enter the pain of that brokenness and hold those pieces together. For Christ is the gold that joins them, that repairs them once more. Christ is the one who repairs what is broken. Our task is to hold the pieces together. So where do we begin? This morning we might begin at a table. It's not our table. It's the Lord's table. We gather here not because we are worthy, but because we are broken. And we just might glimpse how our brokenness can be repaired. How we might be joined with gold and light. How resurrection might break forth even here and now. Because we see it in Him. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Oh God, we confess to you our brokenness, our need for repair, our desire to repair. Give us faith, give us courage to enter into that brokenness with one another, to hold those pieces together, until you might join us with gold and light, with resurrection breaking forth even here and now. Give us eyes to see and know the value of this amazing gift that we have received. For we pray these things in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our friends, as we respond to hearing Scripture read and proclaimed together, we stand and declare what it is that we believe today using the words of the Nicene Creed, as they're found in your bulletin. The Nicene Creed, one of our most ancient and universally shared creeds on this World Communion Sunday. I invite you to stand. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. Our friends, we come and gather together here at the Lord's table. We come in recognition and reminding ourselves that in the early days of the church, as they gathered each week to worship God, they brought the food, the elements that they would share together at the meal. We are reminded of that as we provide in our own offerings as we come and gather together for worship. For the food, the monetary gifts that the early church brought, they would share together around the table. Then they would share that with those who were in need, who perhaps were not able to be present with them. In the same way, our offerings, our gifts, extend our community, extend our care to those who find themselves in need in our own community and throughout the world. Part of the way in which we also represent that today is that we have received several years ago a gift from our sister church in Guatemala, this beautiful table runner. Perhaps you might be able to see it. If not, please, I hope you'll come and see it following the service today. It is a reminder that we are joined at this table, not just by those who gather here in this room, not just by those who join us as we gather online, but we are a part of the worldwide communion and community of God that gathers to celebrate this feast together on this day. As we prepare to meet our risen Lord who welcomes us here to his table, let us pray.
We give you thanks, O God, through your beloved servant, Jesus Christ, whom you have sent in these last times as Savior and Redeemer and messenger of your will. He is your word, inseparable from you, through whom you made all things and in whom you take delight. You sent him from heaven into the Virgin's womb, where he was conceived and took flesh. Born of the Virgin by the power of the Holy Spirit, he was revealed as your Son.
In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to release from suffering those who place their trust in you, and so won for you a holy people. He freely accepted the death to which he was handed over in order to destroy death and to shatter the chains of the evil one, to trample underfoot the powers of hell and to lead the righteous into light, to fix the boundaries of death and to manifest the resurrection.
Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we set before you this bread and cup, thankful that you have counted us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you as your priestly people. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of the Holy Church. Gather into one all who share these holy mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant, Jesus Christ.
Through him, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Church, now and forever. So with the boldness of those who are broken and yet in you redeemed, we pray together using the words Christ himself has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night before he died, took bread, and after giving thanks, as we have done here in his name, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, following the supper, our Lord also took the cup. Once again, giving thanks to God, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is a new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat this bread and we drink from this cup, we proclaim our Lord's saving death and his resurrection until he comes. My friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us celebrate together a joyful feast. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the cup of salvation. All of you, drink of it. Let us pray. O Lord, we come before you as those welcome at your table in our brokenness. We know our own celebration is perhaps just a glimpse of the feast you have prepared. Give us eyes to see. As you have fed us with word and sacrament this day, send us forth that we might enter into the pieces of this world, of ourselves, that are broken, that we might hold them together as you come to repair and make all things new. We pray these things in Christ's holy name. Amen. My friends, we go forth from this place as our service of worship concludes. May our lives of worship and service begin anew. May we enter into those broken places. May we recognize the ways in which Christ comes to repair, to fill those cracks, not to make them disappear, but to enlighten them with gold, so that we might become even more valuable than we were before, because we have been restored and repaired in him. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.